I know plenty of people who wouldn't consider themselves religious Jews or observant Jews who still have that deep connection with Israel. There's something different. There is something different, a sense of belonging that you might not feel elsewhere, where you look around, you know, if we're talking Tel Aviv as an example, you look around and it's, feel part of it. And I'm saying that as someone who's very critical towards Israel. I go to Jerusalem, and even though Jerusalem is full of a whole variety of people, you weirdly feel something.
I feel a certain responsibility to advocate for the Palestinian cause. Do what you can as a Jew to support the Palestinian movement and fight back against this conflation of anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism.
Israel had this very Jewish DNA of David against Goliath for many, many years, and that was the myth. And now the perspective has changed. Israel is the Goliath now. Israel is a strong country. Israel is a wealthy country. Israel has a very strong military. So a lot of people are saying, well, I gave money and I gave my help and support when it was the situation of David against Goliath because I wanted Israel to exist. But now, when Israel's existence is not under any questions, why should I help?
Begins for me from a very early age. Our parents sent both myself and my older brother to a Zionist youth movement camp. I remember the Jewish National Fund collecting box that was on the mantelpiece to plant trees and forests in Israel.
My mother was born in Zhytomyr, outside Kiev, and escaped when she was five. She was brought to Palestine. There wasn't really any discussion of Zionism or anti-Zionism at home. The only thing we did as religiously really in our family were two things, Day of Atonement and Passover. We never did a Friday night. But she would weep when she heard the Hebrew. And funny enough, it still makes me weep now. Both my father and she, I think, celebrated in 1948 hugely, but she was very concerned about the what happened to the Palestinians. Her instincts were for being a Jew, but also for the other people, the Palestinians she was brought up with.
As I got older, I got drawn into the idea of going to live in Israel, particularly to live on kibbutz.
I grew up in northwest London, part of the youth movement, part of a synagogue. And after my master's degree, I moved to Israel temporarily. I found an Israeli-Palestinian research center and I became an intern there. And they did a lot of work around peace education and bringing Palestinians and Israelis together to talk, to get to know each other. And we used to go on a weekly basis to support the Palestinians living along the separation barrier who were being evicted from their homes. These two groups, the Palestinians and the Israeli Jews, working together to try and change the situation, but doing so in a way that really focused on the Palestinians and their experiences. So it wasn't so much dialogue and getting to know each other, but it was, there's a situation that's harming the Palestinians, we're going to try and support it.
Then went to live in Israel, took citizenship even before I got there. I knew that coming up for me was army service, because everybody who is an immigrant has to go to the army. I only did 3 months of basic training, just as part of my Zionist duty.
It was really from spending time there that I got to understand more about what's actually going on, rather than perhaps the image you get from growing up in the British Jewish community.
I went to Israel to visit my mother's family. And I spent 3 months staying with family and visiting some friends of my parents. But I had quite a difficult 3 months because I felt terribly suddenly countryless. I felt neither English nor Israeli. And I was very shocked. I was very shocked by Israel then. It was mainly the way Palestinians were talked about, Arabs.
We went on a route march through Palestinian land in the occupied territories. And we were given this pep talk before we went by the colonel or whoever it was. incredibly racist talk about the Arabs and, you know, how you need to have your gun always cocked and you've, you know, ready for the slightest thing to happen. And that kind of racism was something I had not encountered before. I mean, we didn't know anything really about Arabs. We didn't really have any real image of what the real people who were living there were like. They were dehumanized. We certainly didn't call them Palestinians. They were Arabs. They didn't have an identity. And I found that quite shocking.
I've been living here for 10 years in London. UK correspondent for Israelis, Channel 12, but I'm covering the whole of Europe. A lot of the times when we are faced with, let's say, anti-Israeli views, or when we see people talking against Israel, we very quickly categorized it as anti-Semitism. Wrongly so, in my opinion.
A lot of panic developed after 2000, after 9/11, about anti-Semitism. It was argued that there was a global explosion in anti-Semitism. What was really meant was global explosion of criticism of Israel.
I have been faced with anti-Israeli sentiment quite a lot, not anti-Semitism. But I have met, unfortunately, too many people from the Jewish community who have been faced with anti-Semitism. It's a growing problem.
Real anti-Semitism, and there is a lot of real anti-Semitism around, you know, the rise of the right wing, sort of old-style anti-Semitic ideas about conspiracies and the Rothschilds controlling the world. Much of that is being given a free pass because so much emphasis is laid on this conflation of the idea that what people are saying about Israel is anti-Semitic. A key moment was in 1975 when the United Nations passed General Assembly Resolution 3379, determining that Zionism was a form of racism. It was Israel's foreign minister, Abba Iban, who said that anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism. So that's when you already begin to get the connection, the conflation being made between criticism of Israel and anti-Semitism.
When we're criticizing the actions of a modern state and a government, then we're criticizing the state and the government, not the people. Israel is a modern state that is engaging in practices which are abusing human rights, which are against international law, and we need to call them out just as we would call out any other state. At the same time, I think we can see that certain voices against Israel are anti-Semitic in the language that they use and the tropes that they use.
A lot of the times when you would hear somebody talking against Israel, he would be using anti-Semitic tropes without even knowing that the two are connected. I had some experiences. I've spoken to some of the demonstrators against Israel in the pro-Palestinian demonstrations, and they told me in front of the camera, publicly, they didn't hide it, said Israel shouldn't exist, and you Jewish people, you're controlling the media, you caused 9/11, They showed me proudly how they put the Star of David on the soles of their shoes so they can walk on top of the Star of David.
I suppose by the mid-1980s, I was still a Zionist. I still called myself a Zionist at that time. But gradually, as the years went by, I became more and more critical of Israel. And particularly in the 1990s, when I was actually head of this institute that I joined, I was made director. And we were, one of the main things we were doing was monitoring anti-Semitism and putting out a big publication about anti-Semitism throughout the world. The Israeli government wanted to take the lead in monitoring anti-Semitism, and I resisted it very, very strongly because it seemed to me that this was really a kind of a way of encouraging immigration to Israel. They seemed to want to exaggerate the problem of anti-Semitism in the diaspora.
But I remember vividly that ministers and diplomats were calling me, listen, I'm coming to the UK to speak. I've heard that the BDS will demonstrate outside. I know that you'll probably want to come and cover it. They were using the BDS movement as a way for them to say, here, what we're doing is important and we're fighting BDS, whatever that means.
Whether the Israeli government have deliberately chosen to say that criticism of Israel is criticism of Jews, because that perhaps supports their cause in the sense that you can't criticize us because it can become anti-Semitic. I see the perhaps logic behind that argument. I don't know if that's a true statement of what they've just chosen to do, but the consequence is there.
The Israeli establishment have been trying to use BDS movement, anti-Semitic movements, anti-Semitic people and views to shy away from criticism. I don't think it's something orchestrated. I think it's just a mechanism, and it's easier.
You know, if you support Israel, and you know, you give money to organizations and you go out in demonstrations when Israel is in trouble and that kind of thing, that I don't see how one can simply say, well, there's nothing to do with me now. You know, that's so I think people have to take a certain responsibility. If you support a major cause in some other part of the world, then you can't just wash your hands of it. I mean, I know I felt that when I was a Zionist.
When criticism comes from us, one of us, it's perhaps carries more weight. When someone who's part of the kind of dominant group or oppressing group speaks out about their own people, that's perhaps more significant than when someone, a victim, speaks out.
So you don't have to be in a Jewish group, I think, to come here, but I think it is important that Jews do come. If you feel you have a responsibility and you want to oppose what's going on and you don't think the oppression of the Palestinians is justifiable, then you should come to events like this and be part of it.
If you say the problem with Israel, it's run by Jews, that's anti-Semitic. More or less anything else you say about Israel is not anti-Semitic. I don't think among the people I know there's much connection between their religious views and their feeling for Israel. So I haven't really seen this conflation before. I think it was just the cleverest, wickedest trick that could ever have been played, really.
When the Intifada came to the end, there were a lot of Jewish groups that emerged, human rights groups within Israel that were focusing on Palestinians. And I think you can see within the British Jewish community that they've followed those groups and taken on some of their narrative. I know that when I went out to Israel, this idea of supporting Palestinian resistance or focusing on Palestinian human rights wasn't really part of the British Jewish narrative. Whereas what I see now is actually much more young people engaged in Palestinian human rights and focusing on an end to the occupation. And I'd say even the language of occupation wasn't really present in previous generations so much.
There is a significant group of Jews I know where they do feel threatened. They feel personally threatened if they feel that Israel is under too much criticism. One Jewish friend of mine, she did say, I'm worried about my right of return. You know, will I be able to go back? Would I want to go back?
The narrative I hear from people is more of a fear and an existential threat that actually we need Israel. It's all we've got. You know, if things go wrong, in England, in Europe, in America, wherever, it's all we've got, it's the safe haven. So why are you giving fodder to those who are criticizing this country? And it's not so much out of kind of tradition or history or religion necessarily, but on a kind of, you know, people are out to get us and you're helping them.
I think that the older generation of Jews here in the UK gave money more in the aspect of no strings attached. We'll give money to Israel in order to help Israel. That's what we want to do. That's fine by us. You can have the money, do whatever you want. I think that the younger generation is more criticizing and questions donations more than their fathers and saying to themselves, well, my parents and grandparents gave money to Israel. That's fine. Maybe I can contribute to other places as well. Maybe I can contribute to my local community. Maybe it will be better for me than giving money to Israel, which again, I'm giving money to, but can't really shape or can't really change. Don't really know whether the money does what I want it to do.
And I know there's people within the British Jewish community who would say that my identity is completely tied up with Israel, and therefore anyone to state that Israel doesn't have a right to exist, or to kind of propose solutions that mean the end of the Jewish state, for them would be anti-Semitic, and that's an eradication or a diminishing of their identity.
There are other people I know who went on the same journey, but much more quickly, who came back from Israel, and within a couple of years they had become very much kind of anti-Zionist. And it took me a long time until I finally got to a position where I would say it, and I say now, that I am an anti-Zionist.